Let's go. 9 times out of 10 they had me dirty. During the process of finding mothers, one mother found me. I thought I should hem this one up and get papers on her, then she couldn't run away. I chose correctly. I chose someone who wasn't using. I knew about the ones that were using. They were never there when I got locked up. They never had bail money. They could never visit because they were too busy taking care of their own habits. So I found one of those unsuspecting ones.
I did not understand.
understand what I read. They told me in many places that I was an addict. I had been labeled an addict. From the military, to the jail, and right on down the line, I had been labeled. I accepted that, but I didn't understand it. I had to go out and do some more experimenting before I got back to the program. One of the things I had to learn to do was to understand what the program was all about. I had to become willing to find out what the program was about. Only after standing at the gates of death did I want to understand. I think death is the council permanent. I had overdosed a number of times, but that was kind of like the place where I always wanted to be. It was just before going over the brink and everything seemed okay. When I came out of it, I could say, wow, give me some more. That's insanity. I found the only NA, meaning in the world 131. The final case for me was that I was about to be shot off a fence, and not by my own doing. I didn't like that. Playing cops and robbers is dangerous out there. They have guns, and I don't like being used for target practice. There were more and more cases of policemen sticking guns in my mouth and upside my head, and telling me to lay upside a wall. My last day of narcotics use or drugs of any type, I had just fixed and two policemen got me spread-eagled on a chain-link fence that I was trying to get over. I became sober and clean immediately. Everything became very clear and I didn't want to die that way. Something clicked on in my mind and I thought, it doesn't have to be this way. After that last rest and recuperation, I found out that I could work these steps. The sum total of my life has changed as a direct result. I got involved in working the steps, trying to understand what they were talking about, to really understand what they were talking about. I found there is a certain amount of action that goes with every step. I had to get into action about how the steps apply to me. I always thought the steps applied to you, not me. It got down to talking about God and spirituality. I had canned God a long time ago, then I put that in church, and I didn't have anything to do with church. I found out that God and spirituality have nothing to do with church. I had to learn to get involved. It has been one hell of an adventure. My life has changed to such an extent that it is almost unbelievable that I was ever there. However, I know from where I came. I have constant reminders. I need that constant reminder of newcomers and talking with others. This program has become a part of me. It has become a part of life and living for me. I understand more clearly the things that are happening in my life today. I no longer fight the process. I came to meetings of Narcotics Anonymous in order to take care of the responsibilities that have been given to me. Today, I care. I am addicted to the loving and caring and sharing that goes on in NA. I look forward to more of these things in my life. My problem is addiction. It has something to do with drugs being the means of not coping with life. It has something to do with that within, that compulsion and that obsession. I now have the tools to do something about it. The 12 steps of recovery are the tools. 132 Narcotics Anonymous. Alien. From a very early age I had an intense feeling and belief that I was different. Hence, while other girls my age were trying on mom's clothes and playing with Barbie dolls, I was playing football with the guys, smoking pot, mysteries of the universe. I started using somewhere close to the age of 12. My parents were concerned about the drug problem in our neighborhood, so I was enrolled in a semi-private school in Featuring, Lauderdale, Florida. All this did was introduce me to a more sophisticated drug use. There are many years of my life that I can't remember, and some I wish I could forget. Some periods have come back to me in recovery, but many have not. I have been a skeptic from a very early age. I questioned everything, everything but using. I used to completely block out any feelings and perceptions that I had toward life. I never was very fond of living, although I wanted to be, and this became evident as the years rolled past and my self-destructive behavior magnified itself. At one time in my life I decided that sports was the avenue of personal freedom and acceptance that I desired. And so the addict within me attacked the sports world with vigor and determination. I also felt that if I could succeed at something, and be the best at it, I would surely get somebody's attention. I succeeded in society's eyes and in my peers' eyes. My name was in the papers, and I was on the All-State team twice, received an All-American nomination, was team captain, I had plaques, trophies, and titles. Regardless of my success in sports, I was feeling empty and the success didn't really matter to me. In fact, it turned out to be more of a hassle than it was worth. I was beginning to hear an endless monologue. You have so much potential, why are you messing up your life? Even with my intense physical training, I simply could never stop using. In fact, I thought that using drugs enhanced my ability in sports, and they also became a reward after a hard workout. I did not attend my senior year in high school. Most of my friends had either quit, been kicked out, or had already graduated. 132. Alien 133. I was born and raised in the Miami Featuring, Lauderdale area. So, at age 15 I had enough of geographic stability. My heartbeat was travel, and I diligently pursued the road. I spent one winter in a tent in the high Sierras of California. It was at this time that I was introduced to the drug of all drugs, peyote. The next few years were spent in a desperate attempt to match that particular experience. Still, the main question I addressed to myself was, who am I and where in this universe do I fit? I alienated myself from my family. I did not think that I belonged with them any more than I belonged in this screwed-up society. My main outlet was writing, and I retreated farther and farther into the world of isolation. I did, through the years, try to make things work for myself. I became a Christian, was baptized, chanted to Krishna, became a Christian again, stared at Maharishi Yogi, went to Bible college, got kicked out, went back, got kicked out again. I went to school for training as an emergency medical technician, started nursing school and still felt unfulfilled. This world was just not doing its job to fulfill my every need. I still never felt like I fit into the plan of the universe, and my disease of addiction progressed. Thinking back, I think it was why I used, as well as how much I used, that gave me problems. I went from California to Florida to get clean, and when that didn't work, I went to North Carolina, and then to Connecticut and on and on. When I became uncomfortable somewhere, I moved elsewhere. swimmer on the Amazon River in Brazil. That did not cure my addiction. Even in the Andes of Peru, my addiction progressed. I learned that custom officials love to see Bibles in your luggage, and they also love to hear that your item of business in a particular country was church or missionary affiliated. A few months before I found the program, I was working in retail and found a wonderful supplier for my habit, my manager. Now all I had to do was to make it to work. In fact, all of a sudden, work was not all that bad. I began to work 14-hour days. It was my perpetual and ultimate connection, and life became more blurry every day. I found myself doing things for drugs that I didn't want to do. But I did anything that I had to do to stay high. Using became so much a part of my routine that, at one point, it was accepted behavior to cut lines of cocaine on the restaurant. 134 Narcotics Anonymous. Table. I became oblivious to the fact that what I was doing was illegal. I never could figure out why it seemed like people were always staring at me. I remember thinking, God grant me the power to change the people, places, and things that do not agree with my way of thinking. I could never figure out why this world would not devote itself to making me happy. Today I realize this is insane thinking, and insane thinking helped qualify me for the program of Narcotics Anonymous. Insane thinking is one of the obvious characteristics of the disease of addiction. I had an ideal vision of the world as I thought it should be. I often visualized myself as existing on a moonbeam in a utopian state for eternity. I have always been a baby in an adult body. I want what I want, when I want it. Finally, in Atlanta, Georgia, I found a program of Narcotics Anonymous. Psychiatry was not helping. Prescribed medication did nothing but make me want more. When I was doing amphetamine, the doctor would put me on tranquilizers to calm me down, and when I was cooling down, I was put on antidepressants to help stabilize my mood swings and depression. At one point, I remember being told, just face it, you will never be able to live without being on some kind of medication. Depression eventually became my normal state of mind and spirit. Suicide remained my dominating thought. My favorite pastimes were hanging over an interstate overpass or seeing how close I could get to moving trains. My social life was non-existent, and my zest for life was so low I even lost the energy it took to get more drugs. My bottom had arrived and somehow I was still alive. My therapist at this point was a lady who understood the disease of addiction. She refused to continue seeing me if I would not attend a Narcotics Anonymous meeting. I went to a few meetings and told her that there was no way the program could work for me. When she wouldn't buy that excuse, I told her that I thought the people were using because there was no way in my mind that people could look and sound so happy, and have so much freedom, without being loaded. I remember sitting in a survivor's meeting one night and asking the guy next to me, are these people for real or are they all loaded? He looked at me rather emphatically, and replied, they are for real. Then there was the higher power concept. For me, having had 2 years of Bible college, and a lot of theology in my head, I confused spirituality with religion. This was one of my biggest obstacles in developing conscious contact with a power greater than myself. My I struggle became alien 135. Evident when at a meeting where a higher power was the topic, I told them, I don't believe in a power greater than myself, and I am sick of hearing this topic discussed. After about 2 minutes of silence, a guy across the room stood up, walked over to me, and whispered in my ear, I know where you're coming from, and I want to tell you that this group of people is a power greater than you. That was the foundation for my concept of a higher power. Today I choose to call my higher power God, yet there are many times today when the group is used. God, as I understand him today, is a gentle, loving, and understanding spirit. I believe today that my higher power kept me alive long enough to find the fellowship of Narcotics Anonymous. I am grateful to be alive. The day I surrendered to the fact that I was powerless over my addiction, an enormous weight was removed from me. The addiction said, you can handle it, but I knew I couldn't. One of the hardest things that I have encountered is change. I have had to change my playground from playmate. For me, that was one of the easier areas of change. It was true on day one, and remains so today, essential for ongoing recovery. What has been hardest is changing attitudes, ideas, patterns, and reactions. When I encounter people today who don't agree with me, I need to try and respond to them in the spirit of love. This is quite a change from ignoring them as I did in the past. As a result of working my program, going to meetings, changing my attitude, and relying on my higher power instead of people, even my faith is changing. When I first came into the program, one of my fellow addicts nicknamed me Rocky due to my stern facial expression. I showed no emotion, would not smile, even if I was laughing on the inside, and refused to talk. There were also many times when I simply could not talk, and could do nothing but make a meeting and listen. Many times I shuffled into a meeting, and sat in my corner, and hoped that no one saw me. I sometimes held on to the fantasy that I was a type of Casper the Ghost. The reality was that people really did see me. They tried to talk to me, and they tried to hug me, regardless of my stone face expression. Eventually, love broke through and I began to respond to the people that God was using as instruments of his love and grace. What matters is that the program I have found gives me the tools to live clean, regardless of pain, whether it be emotional, spiritual, or physical. It is okay to hurt and feel pain today. It is not okay to lose. In fact, it is gross to feel anything at all. Apathy was my middle name for years. 136 Narcotics Anonymous. It feels wonderful to care. It is recovery for me to be able to laugh, cry, or simply share some word of encouragement. It wasn't but a year ago that the death of a friend would not have brought a tear. Today I can cry over a man disabled in a wheelchair. I have had to face a bizarre situation or two in recovery. I am learning that there is no problem too small to bring to a meeting. One night I brought the problem of eating a chocolate eclair to a meeting, because I was afraid of moving over it and I noticed my thinking changing. The outcome of it was that in the future I would make sure my favorite bakeries do not saturate their eclairs with alcohol. I do not have to use no matter what. Sometimes I find that when things start going well, I deliberately try to be that I have a good self-image today, but it's better than it used to be. When I was musing, I mastered the art of fight or flee. I would either run from a situation or fight it out, but never face it. Most of the time, it was me I was running from. The words serenity and surrender were foreign to my vocabulary. I am learning that I usually have as much serenity as I have surrendered. For half my life I have been careening wildly through the sea of chaos and destruction. The program of Narcotics Anonymous has shown me serenity and direction. I am growing to realize that my experience can benefit those who still suffer. The freedom that I have always thought I have found in the steps of the program. The loneliness that has been with me for years is alleviated by other recovering addicts in the fellowship. Today, I am not responsible for having a disease, but I am responsible for my own recovery. Today, I can study, keep an apartment, and I can even emotionally commit myself to another human being. Many people are in my life today. When I found the program, I was alone. My purpose for being on this planet has been resolved in my mind and spirit. Today, I know I must carry the message of recovery. Today, I am grateful. I belong in the universe. A little girl grows up 137. A little girl grows up. I was born the youngest of a family of 8 on Christmas Eve. I heard all of my life how my coming into this world is a special occasion, and as a result, I too thought it was a celebration, and continued to celebrate for the next 26 years. My parents were close to 40 when I came, so naturally I felt like a grandchild. Every day to me was supposed to be special. I demanded and got all the attention that I needed and wanted. My concept of myself at this time was that I was to be cared for the rest of my life, and all I had to do was be pretty and smile and the rest would be a piece of cake. I took the responsibility of my existence on everyone but me, and if I wasn't happy, they weren't doing their job. Of course, when things went my way, I took all the credit. To me, no one knew how to make me happy. I was constantly filled with frustration and anxiety because nothing I did seemed to get me to that place called happiness. I was brought up in a religious atmosphere, but I never seemed to be able to grasp what it all meant. I couldn't understand how God could love me 1 minute but the next strike me down to hell. This understanding of mine sent me to rebel against all that I was taught to be sinful. I was determined to prove that if I danced, smoked, cut my hair, or wore pants, I would not go to hell. I began to do all these sins in junior high school and ended up pregnant at 15. I did not want to get married and be a housewife. My first reaction was to have my baby.